Hello and welcome to the Cinema Savvy Movie Podcast, the channel for film reviews, discussions and everything in between. I'm Chris Garner, joined with my co-host George Aldridge, and today we're introducing a fun new segment to the main show. We'll be giving you our top 10 original movies since 2000 to time with our main film review this week, Tomorrowland. We're also following that up with film fights with a triple threat match, so it'll be interesting to see who comes out the victor in that one. But before we get into that, we've got a whole lot of movie news this week to make up for last week's lack of news. So George, what do we got first?
First up is the first stillers come out from the World of Warcraft film, which is just titled Warcraft, and it's directed by Duncan Jones, who you may know from Moon, which is the Sam Rockwell film, and also Source Code. That's the one.
I haven't seen either of those. So and the guy playing, I think the character in the picture is called Orgrim Doomhammer, according to this article, played by Robert Kaczynski. Now, I don't really know anything he's been in, but the name really rings a bell.
He was in Pacific Rim as the ginger guy for Bulldog, and he was also in EastEnders.
Oh, okay. I've seen Pacific Rim.
Yeah, I've seen Pacific Rim. I don't know a lot about it, in all honesty. But I've never played World of Warcraft either, so it's a whole new territory for me. And
Same. I've never played the game, but I recognise the character from the box art.
Yeah.
But what I'm hoping for with this is fantasy and sci-fi are my favourite genres of all time. Probably fantasy is my main one. And, you know, Lord of the Rings came out, and that was an absolute game changer in terms of fantasy cinema. Since then, you've had a few other films that cropped up, but nothing major. You've had your Hobbit films. Now that's ended, I think this could take the place of the next big fantasy tentpole series, and I hope it does. And I hope it gets me into the series more. I mean, as I said, I've never played the games, but from these images, it looks awesome.
I know. I mean, what's scary, on one of the pictures, it's almost the character in the studio, and it looks like a costume, but it's the motion capture, and it actually looks better. This is done by Industrial Light and Magic, not Weta. This looks better than the Planet of the Apes motion capture suits.
And this is interesting, actually. Before we hit record, I found the IGN article, and honestly, I was confused about it, because I thought, okay, well, the first one's clearly CGI. It's really good CGI, but it's clearly a CGI model, and I was thinking, well, is that a screenshot from one of the cinematics from the game, and it's showing you below the live-action representation of the character? Or, and then I found, just like 5 minutes before we hit record, that's actually a CG model as well. And, you know, Weta Digital, Peter Jackson, take notes, because this is how you use CGI to make your orcs look realistic.
Yeah, it looks awesome off this picture, that's what I'm going to say. But I'm intrigued. I like fantasy, I'm not big on it. So it's going to be one of them where I'm going to wait for a trailer, because this has been in post for, it's going to be in post for a good few years by the time it's come out.
And I mean, by the looks of it, this could be, I don't know if there's any other films coming out before it that are based on video games, but this could be our first proper decent video game movie tie-in.
Yes. There hasn't been a good one. I stand by that. Assassin's Creed's probably going to be average at best.
We've got Ratchet and Clank coming out, and then next year we've got Sly the Raccoon coming out. So they look pretty faithful to the games, and I believe this film's going to be entirely animated in terms of CGI models and stuff like that. But I mean, if that's CGI, that is scary levels of awesome CGI.
Oh, for sure. It's scary. That the picture, you can see it on screen. It's just the little details, from the skull necklace to the hair to the teeth. You can see the human part of it, but it's just terrifyingly good.
And if the rest of the film's like that, I think we're definitely in for a treat with that. So that's definitely one to watch. This is the first big bit of news that's come out about it. So hopefully we start getting a little bit more in the next few months, some other characters and other stuff like that we can report on.
And going from an awesome costume to one that's terrible. Some more set of pictures came out of Suicide Squad this week. And it's of the Joker again. And my issue with this is that they confirm the tattoos on his face, which I were praying weren't real, but unfortunately they are. But then they actually made it worse by having the Joker mobile, which I'm calling it because no one else has. He's basically got a purple Lambo, and he's got some horrible like design on it. He's changed the number plate to ha ha. And they're like, why? It just looks like trash.
Well, you know the reason for that is, you know, it's got to be a purple limousine with ha 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 on the back, because I don't know if you know, but the character's actually the Joker.
Yeah, I know, but why would a notorious villain be driving around in a 250 grand Lamborghini, which everyone's going to know where to find him?
Yeah, you'd think he wanted to kind of, you know, evade police capture and all that stuff, but...
This is just too much, and it's clearly a flashback, because Harley Quinn's not Harley Quinn yet.
Yeah, and she's pointing the gun at Joker.
She's Harleen Quinzel, the doctor, or whatever it is, but...
She doesn't look like she's dressed like a doctor. I know she doesn't have to be like in a lab coat all the time, but it looks like they might be changing the backstory up a little bit.
Yeah, it doesn't surprise me that film's fucked.
I don't hate the design of Jared Leto's Joker as much as many other people. I do have a problem with the tattoos, but what I have a problem with the most is DC or Warner Brothers handling this news, because when the original picture came out of Jared Leto with the tattoos and there was massive backlash from everyone, they kind of backpedaled and went, oh no, don't worry, that's not the final design of the Joker. That was just like a 75-year anniversary tribute to the Joker. And right there, it was clearly, you know, bullshit what they were talking. Because that was clearly the design they were going with. And then, as you said, these pictures confirm it. If he's wearing clothes most of the way through, I don't really have a problem with them. The one I have a problem with, and I think most people did, was damaged, tattooed on his forehead. Like, you don't need that. Let the character speak for himself. Let the script speak with the character as well. Okay, Warner Brothers, we get it. This is the Joker. You don't need to keep reminding us with all the ha-ha-has and damaged. And it's too much. It's too much.
Yeah, this is the third incarnation of the Joker. We know who he is. But then it's just the little things like... On set, he's dressed up like a pimp. In his little like suit with his chain and all the buttons undone to see his belly tats. So it's like, you don't need this, Warner. The only bit I can say fair enough is the bright green hair, because it's going to be darkened so much in post-production that you won't see it's that bright green.
And the one bits a bit of the character I do like with Jared Leto's portrayal of it is, you know, the picture where he's almost like dance walking towards the camera. It looks like he's, because he's obviously the lead singer of 30 Seconds to Mars, it looks like he's taken some of that stage presence and theatricality and brought it to the character of the Joker. And I do believe in his performance of the Joker, and I think this could be one of the most faithful adaptations of the Joker character we've seen on screen. I mean, if he's got the mannerisms down and the eccentricity of the character and, you know, the movements down, and his voice actually sounds pretty good if he goes with that one that kind of leaked a few months ago. I have faith in his character. I just think we need to see a trailer with it or the film itself to properly judge, but I can understand why the look of the Joker's pretty divisive, especially considering we're still, you know, Heath Ledger's Joker's still very much talked about.
Yeah, like, don't get me wrong, I like Leto. I think with the day he was cussed, though, this is a good, you know, they've got this bit right. But it just seems that Warner Bros. Don't know what they're doing with him. That's been my issue. And you can sum up the whole Warner Bros. World. We can go into this later with the Flash stuff. But they have no clear plan. Yeah. And it just seems that they just want to cash cows. Like, oh, look, the Avengers have made money. We need our cinematic universe. But you've got good TV shows. Doesn't matter. We need TV. We need films. So there's
definitely
there's a lot going wrong with that. And I want it to be good. I still hope it will be. But they've just gone from expectations to almost nothing.
Yeah, we'll have to wait and see. In other news, the title for the next Mad Max film, I don't know if it's a confirmed title, but I've just, you know, it's the one that's been going around the net, is Mad Max The Wasteland. I guess it's a pretty generic title, though, really, for a Mad Max film, but I guess it makes sense. So I would personally just call it, if you're going with that title, Mad Max Wasteland. I don't think you need the in it, but...
Yeah, it's interesting the fact that the reviews come in, boom, straight off. Title for the fifth film, done, Wasteland. So it's interesting. I wonder if they'll press ahead of it, because George Miller's like now in his 70s, but people like Spielberg prove you can make films at that age. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens with it. But it's a title that it's, you know, it's not, it suits the Mad Max films.
And I mean, it depends what the story is. I mean, I think I've heard that George Miller's already got the story or even the scripts written for the second and third one.
Yeah.
Well, technically the fifth and sixth film in the series. But I mean, if the title makes sense for the story he's telling, you know, go for it. But as the title on its own, divorced away from the story, because obviously we don't know it yet, the new one's only just come out, it's a bit of a weak title, I think.
Yeah, but you could say something about Fury Road. I mean, in all honesty, that was literally just a road.
Yeah.
So, I think it's just a minor bit of news, but what's interesting, what George Miller said in an interview, was that after Mel Gibson left, before Tom Hardy was cast, there was one actor who was desperate to be Max, and that was Heath Ledger.
And when was this film originally going to come out then? Because I know he'd had Fury Road done for quite a while.
What the story of production was that it was about 2000-ish, around, give it 2 years around that, Mel Gibson was on board, the studio was on board. Then the studio said no, but then he got money back. Then Mel Gibson had all these personal issues at home, so Mel Gibson walked out. Then it kind of just hit a blank. And George Miller said in an interview that Heath Ledger kept on contacting him saying, you know, I want to be Max. Obviously, they've got the Australian connections together.
Mm.
So I think it was a kind of off-the-book casting, if you know what I mean. I think it was probably agreed on the phone between themselves.
And you said around 2000 as well, Heath Ledger was in the film The Patriot, which was a film that Mel Gibson was the leading role in.
Yeah, apparently Mel Gibson and Heath Ledger, I don't know if they were best mates, but they respected each other and they got on very well. So it would have been interesting to see the torch passed down, which I think Mel Gibson would have been fine with. But I feel that obviously the passing of him was, you know, a big one. It holds a fantastic career.
And I think it would have been a win-win for him as well. I mean, if the film had come out around the early 2000s, I think the film could have just propelled him to stardom straight away. But I mean, if it came out now, following...
Oh no, it was definitely going to be now. It was never going to be made that early.
Oh, right, okay.
It was purely when Mel Gibson left was about 05-06, because it was just on and off. It was around about that time. So we'd have still got what we got today. Right. It's one of them. The only reason he wasn't part of it is because he passed away.
It's a shame because, man, that guy's career after Dark Knight would have been insane.
I know, he would have been in Rises for a start. He would have been on to bigger things, but he would have been a much, much better version of Johnny Depp.
Definitely.
But it's sad, but at the end of the day, we got Tom Hardy in the nicest possible way, and it was a fantastic film. It's just a shame that when he, you know, brought that out, it was kind of awesome because you had the Australian connection.
But yeah,
it was just an interesting piece of news, I think, because he kept it very quiet. He hasn't said it before, which I think he sort of did out of respect to him.
Yeah, well, I mean, he can't just come out and say, oh, well, we've got Tom Hardy, but we would rather have had Heath Ledger. And I think Tom Hardy would have understood that, to be honest, and I think he probably, you know, would have agreed with him.
Definitely, I think Tom Hardy comes across as intimidating, but he's a wise man. That's what I think. And then moving on from that, for a few more set pictures, we've now got Marvel Civil War, and we got our first look at Crossbones, who is Frank Grillo's character from The Winter Soldier, now back from being burnt and in some suits. And on the set pictures show him in a fight with Captain America, but to get your first look at the proper outfit, it was interesting because it's had some good reactions, some bad reactions. I'm on the side where I want to see it in a trailer before I judge it. However, it's interesting because he's kind of like armoured, not like Iron Man level armoured, but not what he should be, because he's like an agent. It doesn't really suit him in this big heavy exoskeleton.
Yeah, personally, I mean, I'm familiar with some of the stories from the comic books, but I mean, some of the more lesser known characters like Crossbones, I don't really know. From first impressions of the image, I think he looks awesome. I mean, he's kind of got the Bane qualities going on, and there's some pictures of the comic book character on Google and stuff where he literally looks like Bane. He's got the kind of skull, almost luchador type mask on, and you know, he's built like, you know, I don't know what, a brick shit house really. And then But, you know, from first pictures, I think he looks great. And it all depends, as you said, what it looks like in the final film. Because so often these set pictures come out and, you know, they look crap. But when you see them through the lens on screen, they look perfect. My one concern is that if this guy is going to be our main villain of the film, there's got to be some other kind of imposing threat. Obviously, you'll have civil war and stuff. But how crowded this film's looking at the minute, I'm a bit worried about it. Because one of the strengths I really loved with Winter Soldier is that it was just a Captain America film. And this, to me, so far, seems like it's just going to be another Avengers film.
Yeah, that's my concern as well. That cast's getting bigger and bigger. And you need to tell a Captain America story alongside the Avengers, which is a good thing they've got Crossbones, because he is one of Captain America's main villains. So it'll be interesting how it plays out on screen. That could be a finale fight, could be the opening scene, we never know. But it's just interesting. I'm not too bothered at the minute about the costume, not like a level of Joker interest. Which is like, oh, I didn't think they'd do it like this, but fair enough, we'll see what they've got to show from that.
Yeah, but you know, first impressions for me, I think it looks pretty good. He looks intimidating, and if they're carrying on the same actor from Winter Soldier, he's definitely going to get a lot more screen time and development, I hope. And well, I kind of say this with every Marvel film, but hopefully this will be the time we get our truly intimidating villain. I mean, for so long in Marvel, I mean, we've got Loki at the minute, who wasn't really intimidating, but he was a pretty good villain overall. And then nothing. Like, Ultron came close, but we talked about that in our review. He didn't quite get there, so hopefully this villain can actually pose a threat this time.
Oh, I'll say it here, he won't be posing a threat. He's going to be there for a very important scene that's going to change the Marvel Universe.
See, you think they'll do that scene. I still don't see them doing that.
I think they have to do it. It'd be interesting, because I like Frank Grillo. He clearly signed on to eventually turn into Crossbones.
Yeah.
But it's going to be interesting, because it's like a big, powerful exoskeleton suit. It's going to make for an awesome fight scene, though.
Oh, definitely, and I mean, the fight scenes with Winter Soldier in Winter Soldier were brilliant as well, and it kind of looks like the same type of villain he's fighting. Almost like a kind of teched-out supervillain. But yeah, I think it looks great. And this week as well, we got a couple of trailers that came out. Our first trailer that came out was Steve Jobs. I think this had a pretty troubled production, really, hasn't it? I mean, we've had so many actors that were queued up to play Steve Jobs, and then they kind of gave up the role or it fell through. The script's been passed around a lot. We had the one with, and I'm blanking on the name, Ashton Kutcher, that came out a couple of years ago.
Yeah, that's... I haven't seen it, but it didn't get good reviews. Although Kutcher half looks the piece. I think it's risky having two films so similar released at the same time. However, but this has got a far better production credibility, isn't it?
Definitely. Definitely. You've got Danny Boyle directing, and I mean, his films are fantastic, so it's in definitely capable hands. And the script's written by Aaron Sorkin, and he did this script for Social Network, which, in my opinion, is one of the best scripts you'll find for a film. It's so witty, it's so sharp, and if they can kind of... Because it's almost a similar story, almost, isn't it? With Steve Jobs and with Social Network. It's very business-orientated and, you know, the online platforms and, you know, future tech, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So I think it will definitely be very similar in that style. But, I mean, with that director, that script, and you've got Michael Fassbender as Steve Jobs, I'm really looking forward to this film now.
It's going to be Oscar season.
Yeah. Definitely.
And then the second trailer we got, not necessarily Oscar season, more blockbuster season, is Pixels, the new Adam Sandler film, which I'm interested in.
Yeah, same. I mean, when the first trailer came out, I saw a lot of people hating on it. I mean, they always played the Adam Sandler card, but you say what you want about it. Yeah, he's not great, but I'm sold on the idea of this film. I think this is such a fun idea, and I haven't seen this idea used in another film before that I can think of. It just looks like it's going to be a fun sort of family action movie, and that's all you want from it, really.
Yeah, and it doesn't look like an Adam Sandler comedy film. It looks like, okay, it's his mate still. It just looks something different. And it's going to be interesting to see how it comes on screen.
And, you know, it's directed by Chris Columbus, and I think he's a brilliant director. So I'm sure he can bring some of the... I mean, he's done family... He's done the first two Home Alone films. He did the first two Harry Potter films.
Percy Jackson. He's had a good career. I like him, I think. He knows what he's doing. He knows what audience he's making the films for, so he targets them well.
Yeah, I mean, this new trailer doesn't show a lot of new stuff. It's very similar to the first. But it's amazing that the reaction this second trailer's had. I see a lot more people on board with the film now, and it's not really different from the first trailer, to be honest. In fact, I think you get more Adam Sandler in this new trailer than you did in the first one.
I think with this one, it shies away from the Sandler jokes, which people hate. So you kind of get more of the plot, which I think what people were hoping for, because we don't know why they're attacking and stuff. And also you get more Peter Dinklage.
Yeah, I was just about to say, that's going to make a difference, isn't it?
I mean, he's not going to be on board for a crap film for no reason, I'll tell you that.
Mm.
Tyrion Lannister versus Pac-Man.
The imp himself.
But I'm excited for it. It's out in August, I think, in England.
July, yeah, I'm really looking forward to it. I mean, it's a good time for the film to come out as well. It's just when the summer season's dying down and you get the kind of last stragglers trying to get a bit of cash. But I think it'll do well enough. I think it's going to capture the nostalgia of people that grew up with those kind of video games. Plus, you're going to have like the younger generation of seeing fun video game characters in our world.
Yep, definitely. And moving on from trailers, we've got a bit of news surrounding a controversial sequel.
Mm-hmm.
The Blade Runner sequel has now got its cinematographer, which is Roger Deakins.
Yeah.
Which, to me, he's one of the best working cinematographers today. And the fact that he's been cast in this brings so much more credibility towards it. And just for those that aren't familiar with his work, he did Skyfall, Prisoners, No Country for Old Men,
Shawshank Redemption.
Oh, he's done so many, and he's arguably the best working cameraman today.
Mm. Sorry.
I was just gonna say, so having him on board makes me have a bit more faith in it. I'm still don't think they needed to do a sequel to Blade Runner.
No, I'm the same. Yeah.
I think now you just know that the film's gonna look fantastic.
Mm. Yeah, Blade Runner's a film that just does not need a sequel. It just doesn't. It'd be like doing a sequel to Inception. How that film ends is perfect. It says all it needs to say. And I think, obviously, Harrison Ford's coming back for it, but I think with him coming back, it's good. If you haven't seen Blade Runner, then I won't spoil the ending, but it's going to kind of give a definitive answer to an ambiguous question that was raised at the end of that film. But what I've heard from the production so far, I'm blanking on the name of the director, but I've heard they've got a really good director for it.
Oh, I can't pronounce his name. It's Villeneuve. He did Prisoners. Hold on. Denis Villeneuve. I think that's how you pronounce it. But
I mean, I haven't... Did you say Prisoners?
Yeah, it's a great...
Yeah,
great
I haven't seen that movie yet, but I heard really good things from it. So it's nice that they've handed it to a good director. And also, I've heard that the script is fantastic. I think Harrison Ford read the script, and that's why he came back for it, because the script is that good. And I mean, Harrison Ford is, you know, infamously quite prickly in how he acts with projects and, like, coming on board for things again. I mean, he's come back on for Star Wars, but I think that's, you know, he's going to have a big part in that film, and I think that's why he came back for it. And I think that's the same with Blade Runner. If he's behind it and thinks it's a story worth telling, then that's given me a lot more faith with it. But on the whole, I still don't think it needs a sequel. But it'll be interesting. With the level of talent they've got in it now, it's definitely one to watch, I think.
Yeah, I'm interested. Not as much bothered, but definitely got the interest up. And on to another piece of news, which is still happening. It's been a long one today.
Mm.
The writers of the Flash film, part of the DC Universe, I think it's Phil Lord and Christopher Miller.
Yeah.
So they're writing the treatment for the Flash film. And they've confirmed today, well, this week, that Barry Allen is going to be the Flash who's in the DC Universe. And this has caused not so much controversy, but it's a bit of a slap in the face to the fans of the TV show, like myself and you, that we have a Barry Allen on screen. and he's a fantastic one at that. It's this, I know you haven't finished it yet. I'm not going to spoil anything.
Yeah, I just got up to the winter break, so I'm about halfway through the season one.
But Grant Gustin,
he's really
stealing
good.
Stealing the show. I mean, there's a few crossovers of Arrow in every scene he's in. He's loving it. And he's a perfect Flash. And my issue with this is that I could understand if Flash was going to be a Ryan Gosling, a big name star, but they've cast Ezra Miller, who is essentially like an unheard of kid, which is similar to Grant Gustin, so it's a bit of a letdown. But at the end of the day, I don't think the Flash world on the DC TV shows would work with the cinematic one. However, this is just comes down to DC not knowing what they're doing with their structures.
Yeah, well, the way I stand it is I can see both sides of the argument. I mean, it makes sense not to cross them over because, as you said, the tone that's been established with Man of Steel is completely different to the show. But then again, I also see, like, you've done the groundwork, you've established this character from nothing, you've got a good, solid audience behind the character now. Same with Arrow. Like, you don't need to do a film to set their character up, just bring the TV show into it. And I can see that side of it, but for me, who's a comic book fan and, you know, watches all the comic book movies and the different incarnations of stuff, I'm used to different continuities of characters, so I can go, okay, that's the TV continuation of the character, this is the live action one. But for general moviegoers, if they're watching the Flash show and see that a film's coming out called The Flash, I can see that they may be confused because it's, you know, Flash isn't a major character in the public eye, but I think he has become more so now. So I can see that being a problem for when the film comes out. But I agree that they should get another actor, and I'm glad that they're sticking with Barry Allen because he's obviously... When you think of The Flash, you think Barry Allen. So that makes sense. I just think it may backfire on them in terms of their overall audience in the future.
Yeah, because by the time... I don't think he's going to be part of Batman v Superman. He will be Justice League, which is 2017. By the time he gets that, we'd have had 3 seasons of The Flash on TV. And he's guaranteed to have had a bigger audience. But then again, most of that audience will be watching the film at the cinema anyway.
It's definitely one to watch, and it's a shame to see DC go this way because they don't... like with Marvel, you have Kevin Feige, and they've got a plan. They've got a director who's helming all these future projects. With DC, they're just kind of floundering and trying to play catch-up. And with Marvel, I mean, with Daredevil that's come out, it's a completely different tone to what's set up from the movies, but it still fits in, and it's fantastic. And it does tie in. I mean, DC could have done that. I mean, we're getting Supergirl TV show coming out, which, if you want my short review on that, I think it looks terrible. But even while watching that trailer, and I'm used to other continuities, it's still kind of weird when they refer to Superman. Because I'm expecting Henry Cavill to show up as Superman, but I think that's just the age we live in now, where so much stuff coming out is all tying in, and we've got all these shared universes and stuff.
Yeah, the Supergirl show, you're right, it looks terrible. There's too many references to Superman. The word, yeah. It's probably broke the record of the word cousin.
Yeah.
But they confirmed that's going to be part of the Flash and Arrow universe again. Although there's already Supergirl Easter eggs in Man of Steel, and she's following the Man of Steel roots by saying that S is a symbol for hope, not the letter S. So it's incredibly risky the way that Warner Bros. Are doing this. I don't think they know what they're doing, as do DC themselves.
The TV shows are doing a better job than the live action movies at the minute, yep. In my opinion.
And I'm more excited for Flash Season 2 and Arrow Season 4 than I am for Suicide Squad.
Oh, definitely. Definitely.
Plus the Suicide Squad's been in Arrow.
Yeah, and they were great in that as well. So the films have got to do a lot to convince me at the minute, to be honest. But in the meantime, I'm just going to stick with the shows because, I mean, we've got a new show coming out next year. It's going to tie in with Arrow and Flash again.
Oh, it looks awesome. If you haven't seen it, search Legends of Tomorrow trailer. And it looks like the Justice League on TV, but it looks better than what the Justice League will be.
Yeah. And it's definitely one to watch, though, isn't it? I mean,
yeah.
Hopefully, because I want the films to do well. It's not like I'm bad-mouthing DC. I want them to get the level of success Marvel has, but I've just not seen it at the minute.
No, they're just over-reliant on the darkness of Batman. And Batman and Superman themselves, that's they just don't seem to have any hope in themselves, which is going to be their downfall if they have one. I want them to be good, but there's nothing to be excited about.
And our last bit of news now, I know this has been a long news day, but we warned you at the start, there's a lot of news. The plot details for the next two Pixar movies, Finding Dory and The Good Dinosaur, have been released. I'm going to read out the plot synopsis because they're not that long. For Finding Dory, one day while at school on the coral reef with Nemo, Dory suddenly recalls her childhood memories. She sets out and arrives at an institute for undersea animals where she befriends Hank the octopus, who becomes her guide. Oh boy. Now, I love Finding Nemo. I love it so. It's one of my favourite animated films of all time. It doesn't need a sequel. It's a conclusive ending. It's a perfect standalone film. And just from the plot of this, it doesn't seem like it's a story that needs telling.
No, it seems like they're Pixar. It's a weird one because they kind of built themselves. Yes, they did the Toy Story 2. But apart from that, until Toy Story 3, I don't think they've done any of the sequels.
I think their first sequel after that was Cars 2, I believe.
Which was dreadful.
And then you've had things since, like, the prequel of Monsters, Inc. You had Monsters University. What else is coming out? We've got a Toy Story 4 planned, which, that's a whole other argument. But that, to me, is another sequel that doesn't need to get made. We've got Incredibles 2 coming out. So it seems like Pixar now, although they're bringing original stuff out, like The Good Dinosaur, and we've got Inside Out coming out later this year, I don't like the fact that they're doing all sequels because Pixar was so good at creating original content.
Yeah, they built up, if you look at Up, Nemo, Wall-E, they had fantastic original films, and I'm sure I remember reading a few years ago, they said themselves that they wanted to do original films a year. But now they're just turning their head on it. Like Finding Dory, they're cashing in on the popularity of Ellen.
And it's a stupid name for a film as well.
Yeah, like Dory's a character that I love Nemo, but I hate the character of Dory.
Like Dory. I like Dory, but I think she works better as a supporting character, not as a film on her own.
Yeah, she's not going to be able to carry it unless they have like an amazing side cast and like shove her off. But I just don't think there's any need for a Dory film. However, there is a second film coming out.
The Good Dinosaur. This one I'm kind of looking forward to because I just love dinosaurs and I think it has the potential to be that original content side of Pixar that we loved. The plot for this is, in a world where dinosaurs have never become extinct, a young Apatosaurus named Arlo loses his father in a tragic accident. One day, Arlo falls into a river and gets knocked out by a rock, finding himself far away from his home. While travelling to find a way back to the Clawed Tooth Mountains, he befriends Spot, a human cave boy. Now, in terms of plot, it seems pretty generic, and it's kind of that typical Disney trope of losing the parent figure and having to go on a quest on their own. But, I mean, there's a lot of interesting stuff they could do with the dinosaur topic, and I've got faith in this one. I think this one could be a return to form for Pixar, hopefully.
Yeah, they've been working on this for a while. They've pushed it back once or twice. And I wouldn't be surprised if they push it back again because there's nothing and it comes out in a few months' time. But it's nice they're going back to original one. And the concept of dinosaurs living with the human race is awesome. Like, we haven't properly seen that. Okay, we've got Jurassic Park. But that's like recreational dinosaurs, not the actual era. So it's going to be interesting to see how they do it. You're right, it seems generic, but I'm intrigued by it, and I think that's what you get with a lot of their successful projects.
Yeah, I've got faith in this one, and definitely with Inside Out as well. I've seen the trailer to that. That looks hilarious. I can't wait for that one as well.
Oh, that looks great. It's going to be great fun watching that.
But that was all the news for this week. As we said, there was a whole lot of it, but now we're going to move on to something new. We've got our top 10 original film list since the year 2000. How this is going to work is we've both nominated 5 films each, so we're going to go back between each other for our 10 films. We've also got 3 honourable mentions each, which we'll get into later before our number one. So, let's kick it off. Oh,
before we do that, I'm just going to say it's a top 10. However, there's a good chance that there might be one or two films picked, so it might end up as a top 8, we don't know. But there will be 10 films to talk about.
Yeah, and you know, this was, I was ranking these films earlier, and it was so tough because it's like, how do you, well, first off, the concept of an original film, what counts as an original film? I mean, you've got films such as, say, like Pirates of the Caribbean, for example. Like, I always say that's an original film, but it's based on the concept of a ride, like Tomorrowland that's coming out. So it's weird to know what truly qualifies an original film. And then plus ranking these films earlier, I went all through the films that came out since 2000, going through each year, writing them down. And some films I consider truly masterpieces of cinema, but they're not films I will watch again and again. So how I've ranked my list is films that I think are brilliant and ones that I would, like, you know, pop in the DVD player and watch.
Yeah, that's exactly what I've gone for. You put the originality first and then the experience of watching the film. Yeah. Because we're right, we could easily pick something like Birdman. Mm. But because that's an arty, not in a disrespectful way, it's an arty film, but you can't sit there, keep watching it and watching it and watching it. You'll get bored of it.
Yeah, whereas, no, I know what you mean.
Whereas of our ones, they're more mainstream, and I think that's the harder thought, because you don't get many mainstream original films. I mean, we're only doing this because of Tomorrowland, and that's based off a ride.
Mm.
I mean, it's original to a high degree, but at the end of the day, it's an adaptation of some sense.
Yeah, it's a tough one, isn't it? So why don't we get into the list then? Do you want to start off? Let's give us your number five.
Yeah, my number five is one of the best comedy films of all time. My personal favourite for many reasons, and it's Hot Fuzz.
What are you thinking? Well, we should strike now, where we got the element of surprise. The longer we wait, more time they've got to mobilise. I say we go in through the front entrance, take the place oil by oil. They won't be expecting that.
Very good, what he said.
Oh, okay, I haven't actually seen this one.
You've never seen Hot Fuzz?
I haven't seen Shaun of the Dead. I haven't seen Hot Fuzz. And what was the last one?
World's End.
World's End. I haven't seen any of them.
Oh, you are missing out.
I'm like the only person on the planet that hasn't seen these films.
Right, so I think for obvious reasons, this is going to be a spoiler-free podcast, just in case people haven't seen it. So you get two cops, as you can guess, Simon Pegg and Nick Frost.
Mm.
Simon Pegg's like the god of policemen. He like single-handedly like won London policing. Also, he's got a Peter Jackson cameo for 1 second. And he's done so well that the others are bored of him, so they send him like up north to the place of the lowest crime rating in the country, which is where you come into play with Nick Frost's character. And then there's a high accidental rate of deaths. That's all I'm going to say, but it's without a doubt the greatest buddy cop film of all time.
And I've heard it's really action orientated. Is it kind of like a homage to action movie cliches?
It's got a few things. It doesn't borrow references, but there's a lot of intertextuality with it. And I think when I was reading that, because Simon Pegg and Edgar Wright wrote it together, and they watched over 100 cop films together during pre-production.
Yeah.
So it's one of them where you see bits and bobs, but it works so well, and it's a fantastic film, and it's great. It's worth watching. But you just don't see comedy like that. You can get a buddy cop film, but on this level of like wit and pure, there's one scene that I can't talk about because it's a spoiler, but it's outrageous. Mm. It literally takes apart every intellectual villain plot of all time and turns it on its head.
Oh, this might be a good one for a recommended film sometime, because I definitely need to check them out at some point.
You've got this week's pick, unless you want to set to watch it yourself, but I can't recommend this enough. It's a great original film. There won't ever be anything like this, and they definitely won't be doing a sequel to it as well.
Mm. Okay, well, my number five is, it's a completely different genre to the one you picked. My number five is Gladiator.
Will you move your helmet and tell me your name?
My name is Gladiator. Father to a murdered son, husband to a murdered wife, and I will have my vengeance.
Ridley Scott movie, came out 2000, and I love my historical epics, and this is definitely in my top three of all time. Russell Crowe basically plays this army general, and the Emperor of Rome when he's killed by his son obviously gets to become emperor, and he banishes Russell Crowe and sentences him to death. The emperor kills his family. Russell Crowe survives, and he basically comes back, and it's a revenge movie, but in this huge, huge scope of Rome and the Colosseum. And this is some of the best action you'll see in terms of historical, the staging, the sets, the costumes, and honestly, one of Hans Zimmer's best soundtracks of all time. The music in this film is absolutely beautiful, and you've got some great performances in it. You've got, I always have trouble pronouncing his name. Is it Johan Phoenix?
Joaquin.
Way off. Joaquin Phoenix, who plays Commodus, who's absolutely deranged and chilling in this film. And it was the last film with Oliver Reedon as well, who's fantastic in the film. And he actually died during production, and they used CGI likeness on his face and put it on a body double to finish the rest of his scenes. Such a good film, and I think this is a film that most people have seen, but if you haven't seen it, it's definitely worth watching.
And if you're listening to this, are you not entertained?
Yeah, indeed. Oh, there's so many quotable lines from this film, and that's the main one. And other lines like "What we do in life echoes in eternity," stuff like that. It's such a good film. And the opening battle as well. It's quite interesting, a bit of trivia about the opening battle. It's filmed in a low frame rate, so you get that kind of choppy, shaky cam kind of style for the opening battle. It wasn't actually intended to be filmed that way. There was a mess up in the filming process, and when they got the footage back, they found out that they'd shot it in a low frame rate. But they just made it work in the film, and it looks great.
Oh, it's a fantastic film. It's worth watching to anyone that's never seen it before.
And one of Ridley Scott's best.
Yeah.
Easily.
I think it's got to be in his top three with...
like the first Alien. Yeah, and Blade Runner.
Yeah, it's top three.
Yeah.
His last great film, I'll put that there as well.
Yeah, no, I'll agree with that. I mean, he followed this up with a few others. I mean, since then, you've had ones like Prometheus, you've had Robin Hood, you've had Exodus, Gods and Kings. Nothing comes close.
And you know what? They keep trying. I remember on all the Exodus trailers, his best film since Gladiator. I was like, no, it's
yeah,
not.
It's really not. It's,
the fact they're still using Gladiator for marketing films 15 years later sums up a lot about how great that film is.
Mm.
And moving on, I've got my number four, and this might be rather controversial to a degree because of how new it is. I've gone for Interstellar.
We must confront the reality of interstellar travel.
Murph, I love you forever.
Right, that was actually one I wrote down, but that didn't make the cut.
What I love about this is, okay, I'm a massive Nolan fanboy, everyone knows this, but what I enjoy about this is we get sci-fi, but this takes us back to sort of 60s, early 70s sci-fi before Star Wars. I mean, as much as I love it, Star Wars made the action part of science fiction work. Interstellar takes it back to the basics. The story is essentially a pilot goes into space, try and find another planet where the human race could eventually live on, and it's the exploring, because you take into three planets, but you develop the character played by Matthew McConaughey, who's fantastic. Okay, he says the word Murph a lot, his daughter, but
there's a great montage video out there on YouTube, by the way, of that.
Yeah, I was waiting for that cut, because I remember just at the cinema the amount of times he said it was amazing. But this shows Nolan's genius. It was began production in 05, written by his brother for Spielberg. Spielberg dropped out. Chris comes on board after Dana Rises, says, "We'll change it from a Spielberg film to a Nolan film." The whole concept's still there. But I just have to appreciate it more, because we live in an era where you can't make money off original films. Edge of Tomorrow proved it to a degree.
Yeah.
But then what this did, this came along, and you have an intellectual film in November, and it made 670 mil, the 10th highest grossing film of last year, top 10 successful. Put it into perspective, it's the only film that wasn't a reboot, franchise or sequel to be in that top 10, so I think you've got to give credit where it's due. And also it got mixed, it's very polarizing. I think people either love it or they dislike it because of the hype surrounding it. I think in 15-20 years time, people will look back at Interstellar and this will be a Blade Runner, this will be a 2001, because they both started off with reviews like that. It was ahead of its time.
And it's definitely, Nolan was definitely heavily influenced by 2001 A Space Odyssey. I mean, there's a lot of things in this movie that kind of visually call back to that. But with Interstellar, I like the movie. I don't think I like it as much as you, but I still really enjoyed it. I had a few problems with it though in the plot and some of the characterizations, but there were some shots in that movie where it's just space and a small rocket. And it's just the soundtrack builds and then it cuts and it's silent and they just linger on that shot. And that's some of my favourite cinematic moments in my life, is seeing that film and seeing those space shots.
Oh, well, I was one of the fortunate people to be able to see Interstellar live with Hans Zimmer doing the orchestra at Royal Albert Hall. Fortunate enough to meet Nolan, Jessica Chastain, Hans Zimmer and Michael Caine.
Oh, wow.
It's one of the best moments I ever had.
Mm.
And then it's just a beautiful film. That's all I can say. I don't want to delve into it because I could go on literally for 3-4 hours. But we've got to cut it short because there's a lot we're going through today. So we'll move on to your number 4.
Okay, again, very different. Like, before we start this film, I thought we'd have very similar films. My 4th is one of the 2 animated films on my list. Number 4 is Monsters, Inc.
Morning, Sully.
Morning, Sully.
How you doing, big guy?
Hey. Go get him, Mr. Sullivan. Quiet. You're making him lose his focus. Oh, no. Sorry.
This, more than any other Pixar film, is such... This is the epitome of an original concept. I mean, it completely throws you into this world, and it's got all these outrageous monsters, but the setup for it echoes so much with, like, a typical business factory of our life that we can connect to it. And you've got your main two characters. You've got Mike Wazowski and James P. Sullivan, played by Billy Crystal and John Goodman, who just, you can sense that they definitely get on in real life because the comedic nature between the two of them is just perfect. You've got some other great side characters as well. And just the concept of it, you've got this huge factory where the city is run by the power of screams. So the monsters go into kids' bedrooms and scare them at night to get all the power for the city. They walk into one and they get into a kind of turmoil with this one who enters the monster world, and they've got to try and protect her and keep her away from the boss of the company. And it's such a fun film, and it's definitely one of Pixar's best. Real shame that they brought out Monsters University, because I think this definitely... It didn't ruin the legacy, but again, like Finding Nemo, it was such a perfect standalone film that it didn't need a follow-up. It certainly didn't need a prequel. But yeah, it's one of the best animated films of all time, in my opinion, and it still holds up.
You know what? It was on my list. It didn't make the final cut, but it was there, and it was umming and ahhing because I love it so much.
Yeah, oh, it's brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. And Billy Crystal is hilarious in this movie.
It's fantastic. It's just the concept that monsters under your beds, that powers the future, doesn't it? It's an awesome film, and it's one of Pixar's greatest.
Definitely.
Moving on, is that all we got to say on Monsters, Inc.?
Yeah, that's all I've got to say. I mean, it came out 2001. I think most people have probably seen it. If you haven't, definitely check it out. It's a lot of fun. Skip Monsters University.
Yeah, definitely. It's poor. Number 3 for me, this is 2012, came October, one of Bruce Willis's best performances in years, and I've gone for Looper.
I am one of many specialized assassins called Loopers. We eliminate people from the future.
I thought you'd put this film on. This is, again, another one I haven't seen.
Looper is a fantastic film. It's hard to go into it, so... Cut to the future, time travel's been invented, but it's such like a rare format that gangsters use it. So what they do, instead of killing people there and then, they send them back in time. They send them back in time, but it's still the future to us, because they've got these amazing guns. Shotguns are fantastic. And then you have these hitmen who just kill them, and they transport them, they get paid in gold off it. So over time, that gold obviously becomes valuable.
Yeah.
What you introduced, Joseph Gordon-Levitt's character is one of the hitmen. he's waiting, and the guy comes late, and he clocks on, this isn't right. When he comes, it's Bruce Willis, and it's actually his future self has been sent back to be killed by him, which creates this loop. Obviously, it's called Looper. And it kind of turns into a hunt by Bruce Willis on someone that affects his future, but it's obviously it's also a hunt for Joseph Gordon-Levitt to get his tag and get his payday. So it creates this like fantastic dynamic, and it's one of the clever uses of time travel because it doesn't rely on it. It doesn't have to go into the details because time travel is just there as a plot device. It's not, oh yeah, if you do this, this happens, that happens. Kind of uses it wisely, but also it's one of Rian Johnson's first films, and it's done so well for him that he's moved on, and his next film is going to be Star Wars Episode 8. You don't just get that off the back of a average film. This is
They've definitely got a lot of faith in him as a director.
Yeah, and the film looks amazing too. It's quite gritty, but some of the tech you're introduced to is ahead of our time. And I really enjoyed it. When I saw it, I thought, oh, this is going to be a good film, but it was one of them where it's actually a lot better than you thought it would be, and it's a pleasant surprise at that.
I mean, I know I haven't seen it yet, but just going from what you said, it's nice to see that Bruce Willis is still trying in some roles.
Yeah, the only thing was that Joseph Gordon-Levitt's nose had to be done funny to look like Bruce Willis, and he put contacts in, but this is probably Bruce Willis's best film in... God knows, probably since
like Sixth Sense. Yeah.
This is he was on form for this, and so was Levitt, and they had a great chemistry together, and also Emily Blunt, she's great in everything.
Oh, is she in the movie too? Oh, she's so good. I'll definitely check that one out because it's definitely one I want to watch. I just haven't got around to it. There's so many films that I've got to work my way through.
These lists are sad because we could go on and on about all of these, but we have to cut it short, which is a real shame. But it's good at the same time.
Well, it's our top 10, so you should know that we heavily recommend every film we're about to say. But yeah, it's maybe we'll go back and do some longer reviews on them, or maybe for Film Club, if one gets nominated, we can go more in depth into them, because that'd be pretty cool, especially ones I haven't seen. Okay, my number 3 is perhaps a lesser known film. It's a 2004 film. I'm going to attempt to say the director's name. Apologies if this offends anyone. I believe it's Zhang Yimou, and it's House of Flying Daggers. It's a martial arts film, and really at its core, it's a love story. Now, I don't want that to sound like, selling it short, but that's what it is. You've got a police captain, and he breaks this blind girl out of a rebel group, and he tries to get her to safety to her followers. But then... they're also pursued by another guy who's in love with her, and it's basically him chasing them. It's sort of like, I guess it's like Mad Max Fury Road, really, but just minus the cars and explosions. But this is an absolute, if you want to see a film for cinematography, this is absolutely gorgeous, and the action is fantastic. You've got some of the best hand-to-hand fighting I've ever seen in a film, and there's a whole extended action sequence in a bamboo forest. And have you ever seen the film Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon before?
I haven't. I also haven't seen this, but I've heard great things about it, especially the mirror scene.
The mirror scene?
I think it's a mirror.
There's an opening scene with some drums.
Chucks the sword across.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've seen that one scene.
That's one of the opening scenes in the film, and it's almost like a dance. It's just beautiful to watch. And some of these other films that came out around the same time, you had Hero, you had Curse of the Golden Flower, A Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, what I just mentioned. It's probably closer to the latter. You've got a lot of the kind of martial art flying style action sequences, and the one I mentioned in the bamboo forest. If you don't see this film at all, just watch that sequence on YouTube or something. But I definitely recommend the film. It is a... hang on, I'm just checking what nationality it is. Oh yeah, it is a Chinese film. So it does have subtitles, and I know that can often put a lot of people off from it. But if you can look past that, it's definitely, definitely one to check out. And it was nominated for awards for Best Cinematography and Best Foreign Language Film. So if you're into movies like that, or you fancy a bit of a change from the main Hollywood mainstream movies, it's definitely one to check out.
Yep, it's one I do want to watch now you've gone on about it. I will get around to that soon. My number two is one of my favourite films of all time.
Okay.
It's District 9.
We're coming to you from the entrance of District 9, the refugee camp set up to separate aliens from the general population.
They told me I was going to get a vest.
Don't worry about the vest, it'll be fine.
Oh.
Have you seen this?
Yeah, I have seen this, yeah.
Right, so to get the talk of original, there was a short film done 3 years before this came out. However, it was done by the same director. Somehow I've completely forgotten his name. Neil Blomkamp. And I'll just put it into the basics. You have this almost, not necessarily a Nazi regime, but the big bad company. They operate MNU, the deal with the alien shit. Because aliens have come to Earth 25 years ago. They're basically in their own little district area of Johannesburg. And then they want to clear them out and essentially put them into Nazi death camps. That's really what they're doing.
Mm.
And the protagonist, Vickers, which is one of my favourite performances of all time.
Oh, he's really good in this. Yeah.
Of course, the South African accent is one of my favourites. And the amount of times he says, fuck.
Yeah. And they got away with it because it's not actually the proper swear word.
Exactly. And and it's the style of Blomkamp that when he wants to show action on screen, he has faces rip apart.
This film is gory as hell.
And I sat there like thinking, oh, it's a found footage movie, but then it gets into it and you're like, no, this is a fully fledged amazing sci-fi film. And you introduce to minor characters like the Nigerians. It's like, oh yeah, the futuristic alien guns can only be activated by the aliens. So Vickers kind of gets infected and he's over the film, he's turning into one. But he wants to be back human. And it's almost that MNU start hunting Vickers across the film. I can't really explain it because it's just this fantastic concept and it's a great film. It's one of my favourites where it's so refreshing to see something not in America. It's all gone wrong in Johannesburg in South Africa. They keep it away from your big cities. You know, they're set in the slums and it's this tone that if aliens came to Earth, how would we treat them? How would the general public feel around them? They probably would get destroyed like they do in this.
You know, and it's like a message on apartheid and segregation, isn't it, that went on in South Africa, but they're just taking it and putting it to a story with aliens in it. And you know, I love this film. I went to see it because I heard great things about it. I think Peter Jackson produced it, didn't he? They put that in the trailers.
Yeah.
Go on.
Sorry, I think Peter Jackson, he single-handedly got Neil Blomkamp the Halo job, I remember.
Yeah.
And then the Halo film never made it, so they banked. Peter Jackson's like, you know, he's got a good film coming, District 9. They bankrolled it, put Jackson's name all over it, and it was a steeper hit. It made a lot of money.
Yeah, it was only done on a budget of $30 million, and
it made about 200.
Yeah, 210.
Best film nomination at the Oscars.
Yeah, that's insane for a film. And this was the director's first movie, I want to say, wasn't it? District 9?
Yeah.
He'd probably done some like short films before it, but in terms of main Hollywood movies.
Oh, he's done fantastic short films. It's worth looking at his catalogue. And he's done Elysium and Chappie.
Chappie.
And they're not as good, but I really enjoyed Elysium. And I like Chappie for what it is. I think there's a lot of issues which I appreciate, but now's not the time to go on about it. But he's a director that's worth keeping an eye on for the future. And of course, he's been given the keys to Alien.
Yeah, that'll be interesting to see what he does with that, because I think that could be a return to form for him. Yeah. And you know what, say what you want about him, although his films following this have been kind of average, he's still putting out original content.
Yeah, I mean, Elysium, fantastic. The concept of it, I mean.
Mm.
You know, everyone's left Earth, all the rich and wealthy, they're like chilling on like their own space station on Earth's poverty. And he just has these underlying themes of the sort of class and the social issues, and he does them in such a way where it's just not a blatant slap in the face saying sort yourself out to the world. It's just a great filmmaker, and it's sad seeing some of the criticism he's had because he doesn't deserve it. He's admitted when he's been wrong.
I do think the next Alien film will be make or break for him as a director. If it's really good, then obviously he'll get a lot more projects greenlit, but if that is a flop as well, he's kind of had three on the run. I don't think that's going to look good for his career, and people will see District 9 as his one-hit wonder. There's been a lot of talk that people want a sequel to District 9, and it definitely, without giving anything away, it does end where it could go into a sequel. It does leave some ends that aren't tied up. But I remember seeing the trailer for this originally, and there's a really awesome interrogation scene in the first teaser trailer, which sadly didn't make it into the film, or at least excerpts of it made it into the film, but not the full thing. And I was just hooked on that. And just really quickly before we move on, because again, this is another film we could talk ages on. People go on and talk about CGI characters, the best ones of all time, like Gollum, King Kong, Caesar. I think his name's Christopher in this, the alien prawn, who's like the main one who helps the main character. He's fantastic in this, and you really feel for his cause, and he's got obviously his son as well. And this is a fully CGI rendered character, but you have so much empathy for this character, and you want him to succeed.
Yeah, it's... I just love it. I saw it and I was like, I love this film, I'm going to buy it. I'm going to watch. I think I saw it twice on this first day. Not the cinemas, I was late to the party, I got it as a Christmas present. But I saw it, I was like, this is amazing, put it on again. And I haven't done that in a good few years when I saw that. And it was just an original concept that works in its favour.
Definitely. And we're on to number two now, right? This is my number two?
Yeah.
Okay, again, very different. This is the second animated film on my list. Very recent, actually. My number two is The Lego Movie.
Good morning, apartment. Ready to start the day. Jumping jacks, hit them. One, two, three. I am so pumped up!
And I'm counting this as an original film, because this was one of the films I didn't know whether it truly counted as original. Because obviously it's based on the toy line, but then I thought, well, yeah, it's based on the toy line, but the entire story of this is an original creation.
Yeah, I've got to
agree. And everything they do with it. So I decided to put it on the list. I mean, that might be a controversial pick for me, but I support my decision of putting it on the list.
No, I think it warrants a place there. You can't just make a film out of plastic Lego pieces.
And I mean, the plot for this film is pretty generic. It's the typical Chosen One plot, overcoming evil. But it's a tried and tested formula, and it works in films like this, but they do a lot of interesting, intelligent spins on it. This was such an outrage that this didn't get nominated or even win the Oscar for Best Animated Film. But I think that it may have not got into that category because there is a live action segment in it towards the end. So it's not fully animated all the way. It essentially is, but there is about a 10-minute scene towards the end in live action. So I think that may have been the reason why it didn't get nominated.
Yeah, I can understand that aspect, but it should have won Best Animated Film. It was the best animated film in the past year or two, for sure.
And you know, the cast is hilarious in this film. You've got Chris Pratt as your main character, Emmett. You've got the voice talents of Will Ferrell, Elizabeth Banks, Will Arnett as Batman. And I will stand by the fact that this is one of the best on-screen Batmans we've ever seen. Because Will Arnett is perfect.
Oh, well, no. I cannot wait, because they've announced a spin-off for the Lego Batman film.
Yeah.
And it's gonna...
we got a sequel coming out too.
But also with the Lego Batman, they've said it's gonna have every incarnation of Batman ever.
Yeah.
So it's gonna go from Val Kilmer to Adam West to Christian Bale to Batfleck to George Clooney, and I think it's gonna be amazing.
And you know, this was such a surprise film for me, because I remember when I saw that the Lego Movie first got confirmed, I was like, oh god, really? I'm gonna have a movie based on these bunch of toys. But I sat down, I was just captivated by it. I will go so far as to say, this is immense hype from me, believe me. This is this generation's Toy Story. Because it's so smart, and you have the whole aspect of it with the kids playing with the toys, and the film can be seen as its own thing, but it also, by the end of the film, you kind of look at it a different light. And I don't want to go too in-depth into it, but they do a lot of clever stuff with the live-action elements of the film. And this film gets really emotional at the end. Also, it's hilarious. This is one of the strongest, consecutively funny films I've ever seen. And also, where I love this movie anyway, but there's a scene in this movie where I just sat back in the cinema and was like, this is one of the best films I've ever seen. Best animated films I've ever seen. there is a cameo from a very, very well-known property in this film with some of the original voice actors from that film series. Mm-hmm. And it's genius.
I never saw that coming, and I'm surprised it never got spoiled for me. Mm. But when that happened, I was like, oh, fair play.
I wasn't sure, because I've played the Lego games on PlayStation and stuff like that, and obviously that was one of the first ones that came out, and I thought, well, they're not going to be able to put this into it, because Warner Brothers, I believe this was a Warner Brothers film, Warner Brothers don't own the rights to it. But when it happened, it's brilliant. If you haven't seen this film, it's a great family film, and there's some great cameos in it from like superhero characters and stuff. You'll love it. It's brilliant. I love it.
Great film. Definitely worth watching.
So now, before we get into our number ones, I believe we've got three honourable mentions each. Believe me, I could have definitely done a lot more than three honourable mentions, but we'll keep it to the three. So why don't we start with your three honourable mentions? Just go straight through them.
Number three was The Last Samurai.
Good movie.
Tom Cruise one. Love that film. Number two, Chronicle.
Yeah, I can see that.
Bitsy and Josh Trank, boy, I loved it. Best fan footage film. And my honourable mention number one was one you covered, which was Gladiator.
Oh, really?
It was that or Hot Fuzz. And
yeah,
it was such a tough one, but luckily you put Gladiator in your main five.
Yeah, well, it's good to see that you still... I thought that'd be in your main list, actually, to be honest, because when you go back to 2000, Gladiator's your number one, really, isn't it?
Yeah, it was so close. I was like, oh, is it Gladiator or is it Hot Fuzz? Because those two were on par to me for this, but I just went with Hot Fuzz because it's not a better film, but it's funner. In that sense, they're both fantastic films.
Okay, well, I kind of feel bad now because I didn't rank my honourable mentions. I just kind of threw them in. So these are in no particular order, but I love all these films equally. One of my honourable mentions is Finding Nemo. I didn't want to put another animated film on there, and I was kind of torn between Monsters Inc. and Finding Nemo. But when I was thinking about the concept of original movie, I think Monsters Inc. definitely had a lot more imagination thrown into it. In terms of the idea and the story.
Yeah, I can understand that one completely.
But I mean, Finding Nemo is one of the best animated films of all time. I've said that phrase a lot today, but it's true. Definitely one of Pixar's best. And we got into it earlier when we talked about Finding Dory, but yeah, I love that film. Another honourable mention is Apocalypto, which was Mel Gibson directed film. Obviously, he did Braveheart, Passion of the Christ. This was his next sort of historical project after that. And now we've seen Mad Max Fury Road, I can see a lot of similar plot elements because this film is more or less a big chase.
Oh, is it? I've never seen it, sorry.
It's a great film. It's set in the Mayan times with like the temples and the sacrifices, that kind of stuff. You've got this tribe and they're kidnapped. And most of them are murdered by an evil tribe. They take them to the temples and start sacrificing them. And it's about one guy gets away. And the whole entire third act of this film is an absolutely phenomenal jungle chase. And you've got like wild animals. You've got jumps off waterfalls. It's really, really intense nail-biting stuff. If you haven't seen this movie, I'd definitely check it out. It is a subtitled film again. But say what you want about Mel Gibson, but he's one of my favourite directors. You look at Braveheart. I know you haven't seen Braveheart. We've got to do a review on that at some point because that's definitely top five my favourite movies of all time. And Passion of the Christ, although a lot of people complain about it because it is pretty much a like 2-hour torture sequence, it's brilliantly shot and really well done as a film, and Apocalypto definitely deserves a lot more notice. And I hope Mel Gibson can eventually go back into directing as well, because I'd like to see him do some other projects. I think I've heard that he's got one set around World War II coming out in a few years, so I'll be looking forward to that.
Imagine if Mel Gibson directed a Mad Max film if George Miller turned it down.
Oh, that'd be great. And you know what? I think he could still do it, because you look at the... I can't praise Apocalypto enough. The end action scene in this, he could totally do it easily. And he uses practical effects as well. So, yeah, I'd be up for that. It'd be interesting. It'd be an interesting experiment.
Definitely.
And my last honourable mention is Tarantino's, because I had to put a Tarantino film on there, Inglourious Basterds. I was torn between, I had the Kill Bill films written on here, I had Django Unchained on here, but I think out of all of those, Inglourious Basterds is my favourite. It was Christoph Waltz's real breakout performance, really, because I mean, after this, he's been in loads of stuff. I mean, he's going to be the next Bond villain, which I can't wait for, by the way. And it's such a good film. It's Tarantino taking historical accuracy and just throwing it out the window. I mean, the last act in this film is just insane, and it's some of Tarantino's best script work, in my opinion. The acting's great, and although the trailers may make you think that Brad Pitt's the main character and his crew all the way through the film, it really isn't. And I think the trailers make it look more action-focused, and in typical Tarantino fashion, the focus of this is on the dialogue.
It's one of my favourite films. I almost thought about it, but I didn't know if it would count or not. It's a tough one, because I'm happy you've said it, though. I'm really happy you've said it. But it's one of them where it's, because obviously it's an alternate history.
Yeah.
But I'm happy it's on the list. Don't get me wrong. I love that film. I think that's his best film.
Yeah. I wouldn't say it's my favourite film of his, because I still have like a fondness for Pulp Fiction, Reservoir Dogs, stuff like that. But in terms of his latest few movies, it's definitely my favourite. It's just... It's even a funny movie. It's just perfect. It's everything you want from a Tarantino movie, and it's great.
The bar scene as well.
Yeah. There's some really tense scenes. I mean, the opening scene as well. My God. Christoph Waltz in this film's fantastic. I mean, he speaks in English, German, French, and Italian. He's awesome.
Definitely.
Also, Michael Fassbender as well. Brilliant in this film too.
That was one of his breakthroughs as well, weren't it?
Yeah.
Like, God and Maria's in the Mike Myers cameo.
That's like... I haven't seen him since, like, Goldmember. Like, he did The Love Guru, didn't he? I didn't see that film.
I didn't see that, no. I don't know. For safety reasons.
We're not going to sully this list of awesome films with talks of The Love Guru. So, we're on to our number ones. Now, I've had a suspicion that we may have the same film down here as our number one original movie.
I think we do.
And it'll be good if we do, because we can have a good conversation about it. Why don't you go ahead and say it, Will?
It's his masterpiece. Inception.
We create the world of the dream. We bring the subject into that dream, and they fill it with their secrets.
Then you break in and steal it.
Well, it's not strictly speaking legal.
Yeah, Inception is my number one too.
I thought we'd get this, which is great, because now we can just talk longer.
Yeah, it totally works out. I thought we'd have a lot more similar ones on the list, but it's nice that we can bring it together for the number one.
Drop me to kickstart.
Yeah, you start, man.
Right, so for anyone that doesn't know anything about film, Inception is a film about dreams within dreams within dreams. So it's a heist film where you've got the crew of dream thieves headed by Leonardo DiCaprio, where they go into people's mind and they basically want to perform Inception on someone, which he just wants them. It's a simple plot. They're essentially villains. They go into this businessman's son's mind. They're trying to convince him to destroy his father's company so that someone they're working for can have the industry as his own. That's the simple basic of it. But you don't look at it in that way. You look at it as these worlds that Nolan's been creating. I mean, this is a dream project. He's had it. He was writing it since the early 2000s, I was reading. And obviously, the only Warner Bros. Greenlit it after Dark Knight, because this is where we spoke about before we were recording. The only reason I think he did Rises was so he could do Inception beforehand.
Well, he always had his original... He always had his individual films in between the Dark Knight movies. I mean, he did Batman Begins, followed it with Prestige. The Dark Knight followed it with this. Dark Knight Rises obviously followed it with Interstellar.
Yep, and then I think Inception is... I can't really describe it.
It's... it's intense, and it's definitely one of the most, I'm going to sound pompous for saying this, but it's definitely one of the most intellectually challenging films I've seen. I remember seeing the trailers, and the trailers were brilliant for this film because it gave hardly anything away, but it just gave enough away of the concept that intrigued me. And obviously, well, I was sold in the first place on the name with Nolan attached to it anyway.
This is my issue, because at the time of release, I was just getting into film. I think I've always liked stuff like Star Wars. Dark Knight was the one that really like kicked open the door of me wanting to know more.
Mm.
But then I missed out on Inception at the cinema, and I'm always going to regret this. I didn't see it till like Christmas, when I got it as a Christmas present. And obviously, since that, the day I saw it, I was like, this is amazing. This isn't the film people said it was. Dumb people saying it was weird. I was like, no, this is simple. I get it. I appreciate it. What I do, I upgrade it to Blu-ray, and that Blu-ray eventually got upgraded to the Dream Blu-ray limited edition suitcase.
I'd love to have picked that up just for the spinning top alone.
It's so cool to have at home. But I think with Nolan, you've got to give him credit, because he wanted to do this film. And it's the relationships of the characters, because you've got this protagonist who's a broken man. His wife's dead because of him. He performed Inception on her.
Yeah, well, you went into detail on the plot of it, and on the surface, yeah, that's why they're doing what they're doing. But I think the main plot of this film is about a man trying to come to terms with, you know, his past relationship. Because it's Cobb's film, it's Leonardo DiCaprio's film, and the whole film builds to him trying to know if he's... It's really if he's going in... It's the insanity he's created himself through going into this dream tech for all these years. And what I like about Nolan... Now, I know some people can kind of go against him with this in terms of the Batman films, but what he was able to do with this is... The concept of dreams, you can really go anywhere with it. I mean, he could have gone absolutely balls to the wall with this film and like had monsters and completely ridiculous things in it being set in a dreamland. But he brings that realism to it. And there's no moments in this film where I kind of go, well, that can't happen. That's stupid. The rules are set out so clearly. And the realism really helps this film for the audience to kind of grasp the idea and become on board with it. Same with Interstellar as well. It's a space movie. You could go completely ridiculous with that, but he always maintains that realism. So this technically could happen if this tech existed.
Yeah. And then what I love is the groundedness. You talked about the broken man. Cobb won't go into his dreams because he creates a prison where it's the memories of him and his wife. And they eventually start treading into the other dreams. So you're kind of there on this like awesome car chase. And then boom, out of nowhere, a freight train just comes along and just takes out like everyone. You're like, what the hell? But you kind of clock on that this is Cobb's mind slowly functioning into the dreams.
And I don't want this to become too much of like an Inception review, because we could talk for hours on this film.
Yeah, I think... We'll look at it for what we're doing as an original film. It's safe to say there's nothing like this.
Oh, the supporting cast too. Hardy's fantastic. Joseph Gordon-Levitt's fantastic. Ellen Page is great in the film too. Everyone in this film is brilliant. And it's definitely one of the most complex films I've seen. But also, when everyone says, oh, you'll need multiple viewings to pick up everything, I'll agree with the multiple viewings, because I still see this film and pick up on little bits, but... You can understand the plot if you watch it the first time.
Yeah, that's what I'm hitting at. Multiple viewings is great for a film like this, but the only reason I didn't see it was because on a family trip, my sister said, oh yeah, my friends didn't understand it, which was a letdown, because I would have seen it at the IMAX on release.
But and I heard that for Interstellar as well, and I saw Interstellar and I understood everything.
Yeah, exactly. I think the issue is that when you look at these mainstream blockbusters, a lot of people expect an Avengers where something happens. It's simplistic. But then Nolan doesn't want that. He wants to challenge people. And you've got to give him credit. He does it in every film. With the Batman trilogy, he tries to make them as intellectual as he can without like a slap in the face. He has a lot of stuff going on. And you have to give him credit, because that's what makes the Dark Knight stand out. You can look at the underlying themes, the stuff with the anarchy, and the Joker's so right in some of his dialogue. But you can't just get that. The Batman films flow as superhero films, but there's these added themes onto it which helps them stand out from the others, which they do.
And you know, Dark Knight's been given the title, like, it's the godfather of superhero movies, and you know what it is? I may prefer Batman Begins as a film overall, because I think that's more in line with a Batman story. But you just look at Dark Knight, and it is. It totally is the godfather of superhero films. Nothing's come close to the style of that film. Other films have tried, and they failed.
Yeah, I want to add on Inception, though, on my greatest films of all time.
Oh, same. It definitely... It's really difficult ranking the Nolan films, but I probably would say this is my favourite Nolan film.
With me, my favourite films of all time, one, Star Wars saga, two's Dark Knight trilogy, three's Inception. Drop the mic. But as an original film, this is one of the best ones we've had in years. And it's fantastic because Nolan likes the originals. Interstellar, it's already made the list. We've forgotten about that already because of how good Inception is.
Yeah. You know, it's one of the most infamous movie endings of all time. I'm not going to spoil it. The whole crowd gasped and like threw their arms up and went, oh, come on. But it's the perfect ending to finish this film on. The whole ending montage is beautiful as well.
Yeah, the score, the Hans Zimmer score.
Well, that's what I was just about to get to. One of the biggest legacies of this film is the infamous BWAM sound effect that's now used in every single mainstream trailer.
I know, I love it. But then you get the Brahms, but then you get songs like Time, which is...
Oh, it's beautiful. One of my favourite songs.
Yeah, it's one of my favourite songs. I was fortunate enough, again, another Hans Zimmer thing. He had his first ever proper concert in October, and I was there, luckily. And then he didn't do Inception till the encore. So the curtains went up, then boom, he hits you with Dream Within a Dream. And then Time, and that was the show over, and it was fantastic.
Oh, wow.
One of my favourite songs of all time.
Yeah, and this is one of the films that I bought the soundtrack to, because it's so good to listen to. Hans Zimmer's work on this, definitely one of, probably, in terms of his latest stuff that he's put out, it's his best. I think this is his next one to top, to be honest. Interstellar was good, but I don't think it came quite to the level that Inception did.
They're both very different. I mean, you can look at it as one way. Inception's about dreams, and it's dreams within dreams. And Interstellar's the opposite. It's going into other worlds, other dimensions. So you have the ins, then essentially your outs. And they're so different in their own way. And honestly, I'm not joking. I could go on and on and on for hours, but we just can't. I really want it. We've got it.
Oh, definitely. I'd love to review this movie. I'd love to go back through most of Nolan's catalogue, actually. I think that'd be a pretty... interesting thing to do.
He's the best working director today. That's what I think.
There's so much to talk about his films, but yeah, we're going to have to move on to our main review this week. Today's review is Tomorrowland, or as it's called in the UK, Disney Tomorrowland, A World Beyond.
What you saw was a place where the best and the brightest people in the world came together to actually change it. We've been looking for someone like you for a very long time.
Why? Did something happen over there? Something bad?
They followed you here?
Who?
Come on!
I don't quite get why the title's changed. We'll start off with a spoiler-free section before moving into spoilers later, so... why don't we kick off talking about the director for a little bit? So, Brad Bird's, I want to say, second live-action film after Mission Impossible 4?
Yep. He's famous for doing animated films, so he's done The Iron Giant, which is one of my favourite animated films. He's done The Incredibles and Ratatouille, so he's already got a level of connection to Disney, which is obviously why they've allowed him to do Tomorrowland. But leading up to it, he actually turned down Episode 7 of Star Wars just to make this film.
That seems insane to me, because if he's a Star Wars fan, and he clearly is, if he was in, you know, the running to be director of it, why he would... refuse to direct a Star Wars film is just mind-boggling.
I know, I mean, for a start, I wouldn't ever turn it down. I don't know of anyone else that would.
Mm.
I think with Brad Bird, he said in an interview last week that he said Star Wars would get made without him, whereas Tomorrowland could only get made with him.
Mm.
So it's kind of one of them where he probably feels that he's more important to this project than he would be to Star Wars, which is fair play. But it has its references.
Oh, yeah, there's a whole scene devoted to Star Wars in this, and I was aware of that before going in. I was kind of excited to see in what way Star Wars would blend into the story, but It features in a pretty prominent scene, actually, but we'll get into that in our spoiler section because we don't want to give that away. Before going into our general thoughts and more in-depth into the film, I think we should talk about Damon Lindelof as well, because I didn't know he had any involvement in this film, and then it hit the credits and his name was everywhere. I mean, he helped produce the film, he co-wrote the screenplay, he came up with the story as well.
Yeah, this is I didn't know this as well. The credits came on, and I was like, what? Lindelof? I was like, and then I thought, this isn't my opinion of the film, but Lindelof's famous for having a great concept and a not so great outcome.
Mm.
So it was one of them where if I'd have known beforehand, I'd have been slightly put off this, I think. But it was a surprise, to say the least, to have him involved on it.
Mm. I think it kind of shows as well because, and we'll get into more in depth in this, but the third act of this film kind of slows down a bit and it's a bit convoluted, and that's typical with some Lindelof films, I think.
Yeah, so my issue with Lindelof is that his final thirds, they tend to go off the basis of what he's done. So he'll have this fantastic concept and it'll just go wrong. And I think the prime example was Star Trek Into Darkness, because It's all executed perfectly until the final third, when they go and redo the Wrath of Khan ending but twist it with Kirk dying, not Spock. And I think Lost is another one where apparently at the end of Lost everyone's actually been dead the whole time, so he kind of digs himself into these holes, but leading up to that's always been good. And I feel that this is kind of in Tomorrowland, because the film flows well the first two thirds do, then at just the final third they chuck too much in there and it goes off the rails slightly, which is my main problem with the film. And I know that you've got the same opinion with me on this.
Yeah, the third act kind of... I don't know if it was a fault of the screenplay or if the studio pushed for a particular style of ending, but to me, the ending we got didn't really merit the first two acts we got, because it was a slow-building adventure, really. I mean, the start of the film, we're from young George Clooney's perspective, and then we change protagonist to... what is her name? Casey. And then the two kind of meet up throughout the film and then they go on their journey. But then by the ending, it's just kind of haphazard, thrown together ending just because we need a climax.
Yeah, and this is it. It's like this fantastic adventure and you want to get to Tomorrowland. But when you get there, you're like, oh, okay. And then they're just trying to chuck too much at us. And it could have worked, but at the end of the day, it's a Disney film. And I know we're not the target audience. A lot of people are, because Brad Bird's got a good reputation. There's a lot of older people watching it still.
Mm.
But I'm thinking this from the 10-year-old version of me when I was younger. I'd have been a bit bored with... They tried to do too much. They didn't stick to the roots. Because even the final third, they were just, for the sake of it, having all this exposition about the world and...
Yeah, no, I'll agree on the exposition. There were parts of this film where I was genuinely invested in it and I was getting into it, and then you go through long lulls of just conversation and talking about Tomorrowland, and I'm like, great, can we see Tomorrowland again? Because the scenes where we do see Tomorrowland are great. This really isn't a spoiler, but there's a scene towards the start of the film with a young George Clooney where he first enters Tomorrowland, and it's brilliant stuff. I mean, the music by Michael Giacchino complements it really well, and there's a whole sweeping camera angles through the skyscrapers of Tomorrowland. It's really good fun to watch. And then when you get taken away from there and we kind of get into the main plot of the story, you lose the magic of it. They should have kept it in Tomorrowland or made it much more prominent feature in the film, I think.
Yeah, because we all want to see the world. It's what we get in the trailers. We get glimpses. It's what the character has. She touches the pin and suddenly she's round there, looking round. And it's this fantastic world. So we're there like, come on, let's get there. Hurry up, get to Tomorrowland. And we don't see enough of it. I mean, I know it would have been expensive to be obviously done. There's a lot of CG involved. But still, they would have known this was the drawing point. I mean, their ride, this Tomorrowland, was all the futuristic stuff. So it's what people wanted. And I just don't think we got enough of it.
And I think it could have been much more imaginative as well. We see these big robots that are great. We see... sort of swimming pools in the air where people dive through them, and there's moments like that that are really good, but there's just not enough of it in the film.
Yeah, and That's exactly it. It's this fantastic concept and it just doesn't have a payoff. That's my main issue with the whole film, because I really wanted to spend time. Because they build it up so well.
Mm. And I don't know if it's a fact that this was going into it with an origin story mentality. Because to me, wasn't Lindelof involved in Prometheus?
I think he was. That was both him and Ridley Scott, I believe.
And again, that was a problem with that film. It really wasn't... What we wanted from Prometheus, we didn't got, but we were promised it at the end of the film for future films, and I think this is similar to what this film did.
Yeah, when this film was being made, I'd seen people saying, this is going to be like Hogwarts, but Disney, so you'd think they'd be transported to this world where they'd learn new stuff, but we don't get that. And that's what everyone thought they would get. So it's... That's my main issue with it, and it's sad because it's arguably the most important part of the film.
Oh yeah, and if they'd have gone all out with Tomorrowland and this and really focused on the world building, this could have been, even if the plot wasn't that great, at least you could say, wow, the imagination and originality put into Tomorrowland was absolutely phenomenal. But as such, we kind of get a thrown together plot, and the reason we buy our ticket to see the film, we don't get to see it, and it's a bit frustrating really. Because when we do see it, it's so good.
It reminds me of Godzilla, that's the one. They hyped up the reveal of Godzilla last year so much, it completely backfired. The difference of this and Godzilla is Godzilla's been seen on screen at least a dozen times, whereas Tomorrowland hasn't.
Hmm. And I guess we can kind of give a few general opinions now, if we haven't given them already, really. I don't think this is a bad film. I just think it's an okay film that doesn't merit much replay value at all. I mean, there's some great performances in it. I think that the one who plays Casey, Britt Robertson, was really good in the film. Clooney was solid enough, and it's always good to see Hugh Laurie in a film again. But besides that, it's just a kind of paint-by-the-numbers family movie when it was promised to be so much more than that, and especially from Brad Bird directing, I expected a little bit more from it.
Yeah, I thought the cast were great. I mean, it's not often you see George Clooney come into films these days where he's a kind of minor character and he's a bit shadier than he normally is, so it's great that Brad Bird could get that out of him.
Mm. My only problem with the performances is, and this didn't completely take me out of the film, but towards the beginning of the film it was most prominent, the line delivery and how they say their lines was kind of... It was very whimsical and it didn't seem naturalistic. It seemed very campy and I don't really know how to describe it. It seemed very Disney. And I know it is a Disney film, but when you see live action actors...
It was very generic.
Yeah, it was kind of sitcom-y almost. George Clooney's trying to recount a story and Casey keeps interrupting him. And it's just the how the lines flowed in that bit and the dialogue, I think it was a bit sort of hokey in parts.
Yeah, I think that's just them targeting the younger demographic where they'll laugh when something gets interrupted or... You know what I mean? I mean, I saw it on Friday morning, so all the kids are at school, so that's great for me. There's no screaming at the cinema. But it would have been interesting to see it in that audience, just to see the younger people's reactions to the film. Because there were some things that are so blatantly engineered towards the younger generation, but then again, there's some of it which seems too articulate for an under 12 or something.
I honestly think they'd be bored with it. I mean, I know, as we said, we're not really the target audience for this, but I think if they'd have focused on the young George Clooney character throughout the whole film and it was kind of this whimsical journey into Tomorrowland, and then obviously kids would be able to identify with the main character with this sense of wonder, I think it would have worked a lot better.
Yep.
But as it is, as I said earlier, you get these long lines of dialogue, just lots of exposition when you just want to get there and experience it. And I think that's the film's biggest problem. And I mean, box office turnout hasn't been great for it at the minute. I mean, what's it standing at the minute? Like 60 million?
Yeah, 60 mil worldwide opening. It's not bad, but for a film with a 200 mil budget, it's not great.
And Disney haven't been really hitting it out of the park with live action movies recently. I mean, the infamous example's John Carter. And obviously this isn't as bad as that, and I think this will definitely make its money back eventually, but it's not the hit they were expecting from it.
No, I think the issue of Disney is that it's been released very close to Avengers. I mean, of course this would have been harder to make, but If they'd have had, say, a blockbuster in January, their Avengers in May, and then Star Wars December, they'd have had three big ones. Or this August, September, but to release a film like this in the middle of blockbuster season is very hard to get your money back, especially when all the animated films like Minions and Inside Out are going to be released in the next month or two as well. So that's going to damage Disney's own stuff with the rival companies.
I was going to say September would probably be in the best time for this, especially in a few weeks you're going to have Jurassic World coming out. This is just going to completely drop off. It's probably going to drop off really soon, actually. I don't see this bringing in many audiences. But then again, is there that many family films out at the minute? There is a window for it, I think.
Yeah, but the other thing is, we forget that The Avengers is a kids' film. This is massive to them. I mean, growing up was Star Wars for us. But for the kids that are 4 or 5, at the minute, they haven't had a Star Wars film. So they're all growing up with The Avengers. So I think Disney have kind of shot themselves in their own foot by releasing two of their juggernauts with a 3-week gap in America, haven't they?
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, I enjoyed this film. I think it just has a final third which damages the lead-up, because it's a fantastic build-up. And the scenes we get of Tomorrowland are great. I just don't think it's good enough.
Would you recommend this film, though?
I do recommend it as a watch, just to see people's opinion of it. However, if you're going to be saying something like, oh, Mad Max or Tomorrowland, then it's a safe bet to say Mad Max.
Oh, yeah, still going to see Mad Max. And when I came out of this film, I saw the the main lobby of the cinema. I just looked up and thought, God, man, I could have made another showing for Mad Max again. But
oh, it's tempting. I've seen it twice now, and I'm probably going to go again next week.
Oh, it's so good. But yeah, my final thoughts really are, it's nice that we're getting original movies like this, and I think we should support them, but it's just kind of, it's a bit cliche towards the end. It's nothing special, it's nothing dazzling. It's a very paint-by-the-numbers family entertainment film, and I guess in that respect it's kind of successful. I don't regret seeing this film, but it's not one I'll ever go back to, probably.
No, it's one of them where if it goes on Sky Movies or something, I'll give it another watch just to see what it's like. But I thought it could have been better, but then again, that's probably my fault for wanting a Brad Bird amazing film and forgetting it was Disney. I think that's been my main issue with it, is that myself included, a lot of people have hyped up this film.
You've got some fun moments. I don't think it's poorly directed at all. I think the problem is, as we've said before, is just a screenplay thing, and maybe it could have done with more slightly altered story beats in between to kind of quicken up the pace and be a bit more entertaining to watch, I think.
Yep.
I.e. more Tomorrowland.
Definitely. That's all was missing. Tomorrowland was missing from Tomorrowland.
Yeah. It's like the Transformers from Transformers.
We're about to start spoiling stuff, so if you want to get around this, then just go to the 1:52 mark, or if not, get ready. Moving on, should we hit spoilers?
Yeah, and there's one scene in particular we want to talk about here, so go for it.
So, a month or two ago, Chris Stuckman was on Schmoes Know and says, no, he was on Movie Fights, he says, oh, there's the Star Wars scene. Then he covered his mouth, realised he shouldn't have said that. Mm. And then I completely forgot about this scene at the cinema, whereas you hadn't. And then what you get, there's this fantastic scene where they're tracking down where the pins come from, and they go into the shop. And from the get-go, it is essentially a sci-fi like Easter egg shop. It's called Blast from the Past, but there is every bit of merchandise from Star Wars to Iron Giant to Star Trek,
Incredibles,
and it was a fantastic scene because it was one of the better action pieces as well from the film as well. But I was just there like, oh my god, like this is incredible. Like that's probably like one of my standout scenes of the whole year.
I do kind of, in films, when they do this kind of thing, I do usually resent it because I think, oh, it's a cheap marketing tactic, it's product placement. But in the context of the movie, it's kind of a comic book store, really, isn't it? Film merchandise store. So it makes sense to have all that stuff there. But I did find myself looking at the background more than the actual actors in the frame and what they were saying. So obviously I noticed all the Iron Giants on the shelf. There's a life-size stormtrooper, there's the Han Solo frozen in carbonite. They even play the Star Wars theme at one point.
And this is what I was going to say. When I sat there at the cinema and it came on, I was like, hey, up, the guy that turned down Star Wars gets to the theme before J.J. Abrams does.
Yeah.
And it was this great scene. And it was fun, though. There's this action set piece where they even use, like, Han Solo and Carbonite to trap someone. And I don't know the name of the robot, but there's this robot that's from a classic sci-fi film. I've forgotten the name of it. And it just gets, like, blown up.
Hmm. And were you paying attention to, like, the sound effects used in that whole fight? Because there was some used from Toy Story 2, like the Emperor Zurg gun.
Oh, yeah, the Emperor Zurg was there. He was on the side of a desk.
Yeah.
But you're absolutely right. I was there watching the background because I was waiting for an Iron Giant reference because, obviously, it's one of Brad Bird's first films.
Really underrated film as well.
I think he's mentioned it, finally a Blu-ray release, but also a cinema re-release.
Oh, that would be cool.
But it was like, oh, finally, there's an Iron Giant, and then it cuts, and there's like five Iron Giants in the cabinet. And it's like, oh, this is cool.
Although, that was a scene for me that felt, I don't want to say a different tone to the rest of the film, but it was definitely a lot more hokey, and it's like the henchmen in it. Have you ever seen that god-awful Matthew Broderick Inspector Gadget film?
Yes, the guy with the teeth, he looks exactly... Yeah. He looked like Cristiano Ronaldo. That's when I first saw him. I said, like, he's just, like, cocky. But it worked in their favour. It was just, like, a bizarre, like, robot.
Yeah, they have, like, these wax faces and sort of comb-backed greaser hair. And it was, like, the evil Matthew Broderick Inspector Gadget in that film. It's a terrible film, so don't watch it if you don't know what I'm talking about. But it was kind of... It wasn't what I was expecting from it. It came kind of out of left field.
No, because we don't actually know why the robots are there. That's something it doesn't address.
No.
I thought it'd be part of the government in Tomorrowland not wanting people to find out, but it wasn't even that.
Well, we established that Tomorrowland have good robots, like the main girl in it, Athena, who kind of go around recruiting dreamers to come to Tomorrowland. So I assumed it was basically the evil version of that, who were sent out to try and capture them or destroy them, but it wasn't really made clear enough.
No, they don't delve into it, because it's a cool concept, because I never really thought of the robots until the trailer spoiled it. But it's just a loose end that doesn't get tied up. But what's great, though, is their guns. I mean, for a Disney film, they're like, evaporating people. And it's like, you didn't expect that at all, especially...
Kills, like, four police officers.
Yeah, and it's in space, like, and then he's just there, like, smiling, like, with his dodgy teeth.
Yeah,
I can't get it out of my head now, Inspector Gadget.
No, that was just the first thing that came to mind when I watched it. It was just immediate, and it didn't take me out of the film. I just thought, oh, okay, that's like a really random direction to make your henchman like Inspector Gadget, but okay.
Yeah, so they were cool.
To be honest, it just got me more hyped for Star Wars. Just hearing that theme, I was like, oh, it's coming.
Oh, yeah.
December, it's coming.
It's just spotting the merchandise on the shelves and stuff. Oh, yeah. It was great fun. I bet they loved filming that, all of them.
Oh, definitely.
Moving on, I think we've mentioned a lot that the final third kind of dampens the film. Going into it in slightly more detail, they add in the villain of, is it Governor Nix, Hugh Laurie's character?
Yeah.
They just kind of make him a villain just because they felt like they need one.
Yeah, and you know what? I kind of had I defended Immortan Joe from Mad Max. I didn't think he was completely a villain. But here, this is just a guy who's lost hope. He's not really a villain, and he doesn't do anything particularly villainous. It was just an opposed form of thinking, really. He didn't deserve the end he got in this film, where he's crushed by, like, a goddamn tower.
No, he's literally just there. He kicks... Obviously, we learn as the film carries on. Kicks out George Clooney, because George Clooney invents, like, the machine that guesses their date. So he kicks George Clooney out of Tomorrowland. And then it cuts to him again... And he's now a believer that the world's going to end exactly like George Clooney. So it's kind of like, oh, wait, was there any need for you to kick him out because you believe it?
Yeah, and you had that parallel between Clooney and Hugh Laurie in this film. And it would have been a bit preachy at the end. And obviously, this is why I think it was a studio thing that they wanted a villain to, you know, want to try and overthrow at the end in a bit of an action scene. But it would have been more of a poetic ending if they restored his hope at the end, because that's what the whole moral of the story was.
Yeah, and he's not... You said it perfectly. He's not a villain. He doesn't do any villainous stuff. And what annoyed me most was, he's like, oh yeah, we think she can change it. So he's all intrigued. He goes into the room, shows it, and he sees that she could change it. But then he just proceeds to try and kick him out again. It's like, there's no need. This is a guy that believed in his jetpack stuff, because eventually the jet he lets in George Clooney to the world when George Clooney's a kid. And he clearly takes the jetpack idea and makes it better. So he's clearly a believer of the right stuff, but in this he's just completely turned on it.
Yeah, and I think it would have been a nice visual metaphor for the ending as well, if obviously when Hugh Laurie's depressed and he doesn't believe in anything anymore, Tomorrowland's all in ruin and it's not active. And by the end of the film, if he'd restored his faith, he could have had like a shot where it's all been rebuilt, there's all new stuff, it's all populated again. And I think it would have just been a... It would have made more sense for an ending like that, but as such, we get the kind of rushed and like slapped together ending that we did.
Yeah, because it's annoying, because I said earlier that I thought this would be like what Harry Potter is, to go into this world, and the final 2 minutes is... So they, quote, defeat Hugh Laurie's character. And it annoys me, because the only reason there was a fight in the first place was because they just wanted to shut off the power for a minute. That's all it is. They just wanted to shut off the power, then turn it back on. And he's like, no.
Yeah, and thrown in the ending as well. I guess we'll talk about a positive thing, was Clooney and the character of Athena.
Yeah, I mean, we've both got different opinions, but I think there's some similarities in it. So you're introduced to George Clooney as a boy, and it's so blatantly that he likes this girl. And then it's later revealed that this girl is actually a robot, so she's programmed. And George Clooney's like depressed and all that because he found out as a young kid. So I thought it's an interesting dynamic they play the film off, because you can work out within a minute that she's a robot. The other way around. You work out within a minute that he fancies her. But then the way they reveal her to be a robot, it's nothing big, it's nothing dramatic. She just kind of just like unplugs a wire or two, and she's like, yeah, I'm a robot. And I thought, I really enjoyed that, because for once they didn't need this big dramatic twist to show it. And then her death, it's more her taking herself to save George Clooney's character, because she does a prediction.
I did think that scene was actually really well done at the end, where she plays back the audio tapes. The only thing was, it was kind of uncomfortable. It makes sense in the context of the film, but...
Yeah.
I don't know, there was a slight uncomfortable tone towards the end.
I can see where you're coming from, but I was behind it. But I think that's because it worked for me. I think it's probably going to be a split opinion, this. If it works for some people, then I think it will work. But I think if it doesn't work for some of the others, then we'll have this uncomfortable opinion. So I think we both share the same belief that they work, but just to that one side of things.
Yeah, and it's weird with the character of Athena. In the opening scene, where it's with Kid Clooney in Tomorrowland, and there's a really awesome scene, by the way, I want to mention, where they go on the It's a Small World ride. That was great, and it just made me want to go to Disneyland again. I thought in that opening, she was really good in the role, but then like the whole middle section, I found her acting intolerable. I really hated her character. To the point where at the end where her character died, I was like, oh, thank God. It sounds messed up, but I just really didn't care for her character.
Yeah, I get where you're coming from, because she's one of them annoying people, but she just reminded me of Hermione Granger the whole time. And I could get behind that. But there were some scenes when it was just too much of her trying to lead the pack.
Plus, she was just completely overshadowed by Britt Robertson playing Casey, because I thought she was awesome. And it was weird. She really reminded me of Jennifer Lawrence for some reason, like in appearance and mannerisms and acting. I think I don't know what else she's been in. I haven't seen her in anything else, but I think she's definitely an actress to watch, because I thought she was great in this.
Yeah, I think she's been in a few TV shows, but nothing as a major as this, because obviously she's the lead. But I see where you're coming from, because when you get Lawrence in real life, she's like, oh my God, they have food here at the Oscars, and she's very normal. I think that's what a lot of people would be like. And they actually kind of take that and put it on screen. They try to have like a really normal teenage girl, which I think it works. I enjoy it. But you're right about the Jennifer Lawrence comparison, that they're kind of similar, and you could easily see Jennifer Lawrence being that main lead.
Oh, definitely. And yeah, that's really all the key roles in the film, I think. I don't really know what else we could talk about. One thing I did think was cool was how they changed the actual Disney logo at the start of the film to mirror Tomorrowland. I really loved that.
Yeah, because I think it's not as good as the time they did it in Tron Legacy, but it was pretty cool. But then it got me thinking. I was like, oh, please, please, please don't do this for Star Wars and have Coruscant.
Oh,
but
yeah. I don't want to see that Disney logo at all in front of Star
they've
Wars.
They've already announced that it's going to be like that trailer, so you get Lucasfilm and then the film.
Oh, that I'm going to miss the 20th Century Fox, but, you know, I'd rather have that in the Disney logo.
Exactly. Put it on after, that's fine, because it's got a bad robot as well, and I hate that logo.
Yeah.
But I think that's mainly on Tomorrowland. It wasn't a film that we were hyping up like Mad Max, but it was just one that was intriguing, I thought.
Yeah, no, there's some good scenes. There's a whole house escape that was pretty inventive. The whole Eiffel Tower sequence in the film with the rocket launch. That was quite nice visuals to watch. And as we said, Tomorrowland, when we see it, the whole jetpack flying through the skyscrapers was amazing.
Oh, some of it was great fun. I think, again, it's just that final third just kills it off ever so slightly. But it's going to be interesting to see how it does eventually in its box office run.
Yeah, I don't see it doing too well, to be honest. I think it's going to be... I don't know if it'll get to number one. I think it will for a couple of weeks, and then it'll just drop off. And then...
Yeah, it got 33 mil American opening weekend of number one, but there were about three films in the 20s, so it didn't dominate, and it was less than they predicted.
I think it's standing at a 49% on Rotten Tomatoes at the minute, and it's definitely not a 49% movie.
No, I think it's a solid adventure film. It's an almost typical Disney film in like a non-offensive view. And I think it does its job, but I think the negativity is because a lot of people thought this is going to be like Brad Bird doing something incredible, whereas, again, we just all forgot that this is, at the end of the day, a Disney film.
Yeah. And, I think that's pretty much our review. I think I've said everything I'll need to on Tomorrowland, if you've said everything.
Yep, I think that's everything I've got to say.
Okay, now we get into our next segment. This is going to be a triple threat match. We're going into film fights. So, who are our contenders for this segment?
So, normally we take one thing from the news, put it in a fight with one thing from the main show. Because we each got our two top five lists, I thought it'd be better if we take a character from each of our films and pit it against someone in the news. The ones I thought of straight away is that big orc warrior from Warcraft.
Oh, okay.
So yep. Him. And for me, I want him versus Vickers from District 9. And this is Vickers in his exoskeleton that allows him to have alien shit.
My contender I'm going to stick to a Disney theme to tie in with Tomorrowland, but I'm going to pick Sully from Monsters, Inc. in Rage Mode.
This is going to be a great fight.
Well, the first... Really, I think the two on the level playing field here are Sully and the Orc. I'm sorry, I can't remember the name. From Warcraft.
I don't know his name. I'm just going to call him Orc, because that's what it is.
Yeah, we'll call him. I think they're on level playing fields in terms of ability here, and it's the same kind of build, but, you know, Vickers has got... guns and tech, but in the film he is very clumsy with it and doesn't know how to use it. So are we going with Vickers knowing how to use it fluently, or still faltering like he doesn't?
It's going to be final 5 minute Vickers when he's kind of dominating with everything.
Okay, well,
I think I know that Vickers will win this. Do you want to know why?
Why?
Because he's got that pig gun where he shoots it and explodes the pig.
Oh. That is the best bit of that film.
I don't think Sully or the Orc have a chance. Unless, obviously, they both annihilate him in a fist fight. But I
think that the Orc and Sully would realise that they're matched and they would tag team against Vickers.
I know, but are they going to be able to... I mean, let's be honest, you don't really know anything about this Orc. Is he slow? Is he fast?
I think he's on the front cover for most of the World of Warcraft games, so I think he's probably a really good warrior. My money's on the Orc. I'm going with the Orc. I think he could take out the guns on Vickers' suit with his weapons. And I think because he tag teams with Sully, they overthrow them, and then the Orc's got weapons and you just slaughter Sully and he's the winner.
I think Vickers would just do it. He'd just get into that exoskeleton, just pick up that Orc and just like snap him or explode him. I don't know. It's an interesting fight because, let's be honest, Vickers would get annihilated in a fist fight, but because he's got all the tech... And, you know, he could just fly off and never come back.
Tech's the one thing that Vickers has got in this fight that the others don't have, so...
Well, he's also got camouflage.
Yep. This is true, and he's got the pig gun, as you mentioned, so I think this will be a close fight, but, you know what, just for the sake of argument, I'm still sticking with the Orc, because because he looks cool.
Oh, I think I think Sully's too nice to have a fight, so I think that kind of rules him out. But you kind of silly about Mike. I mean, could you imagine Mike's eye exploding from the pig gun?
Oh god,
that'd be hilarious. I don't know. It's really close because we just don't know a lot about this orc. Is he like 10 foot?
And is he lumbering or is he fast moving? I mean, Vickers in the suit is kind of stumbling around the place and
yeah,
even up until the very end of the fight.
Oh, I don't know. Vickers gets battered, but I'm going to stick with Vickers. I think we'll call this one a draw.
We'll call this one a draw and we'll have to let the audience decide on this one because I think this is a close fight.
But I think Sully's just gone within 10-15 seconds.
He's too nice, he's too plushy. He has no business in a gladiatorial fight in a triple threat match with these people.
No, Randall could have worked, but
see, he could camouflage, he could sneak attack everyone.
He could turn into a prawn.
Yes.
But so can Vickers, so.
Well, Vickers is a prawn at the end of the movie.
That's
alert.
A good point. Oh no, I love that film. That's one of my favourite endings. It's like, ha! They've gone and left you, and now you're a fucking prawn. Yeah.
And hopefully we get a sequel.
I think we will. Give it Alien 5, that'll make money. I think we'll get a sequel.
Okay, well, obviously comment below. Let us know who you think should win the film fight. Next up, we go into our recommended movie, which is where each week we take it in turns to pick a movie that vaguely ties in with our main review. Obviously today was Tomorrowland, and this week is my time to pick. So, at first it was really difficult to think of what kind of movie to go with to tie in with Tomorrowland. I mean, obviously it's a sci-fi film, it's a family film, it's a Disney movie, so I was thinking, but I went with the angle of taking someone and transporting them to a new place. Still in the sci-fi genre, and it's a family comedy film. And I don't know if you've seen this film, it's called Galaxy Quest.
Oh, I've seen bits of it. It's good, it's a Star Trek spoof, isn't it?
Yeah, and obviously you can have a really, really vague tie-in with the whole J.J. Abrams thing with Star Trek as well. Because this got actually ranked amongst Star Trek fans, I was going to say Star Wars then, amongst Star Trek fans as one of the best Star Trek movies. Because it's such a good satirical comedy on that, and it's just a lot of fun. It's got a great cast. You've got Tim Allen, you've got Alan Rickman, Sigourney Weaver, and it's just, it's brilliant.
I'm definitely going to, this is going to be a good one because it's such a classic film.
Oh, definitely. I think it's got quite a cult following now, actually. I think a lot of people have seen it and
yeah, it has.
You know, picking it up.
I think it's because it's so wacky and different, although a bit similar to Star Trek, obviously.
Hmm.
But that's actually one of the... It's going to be good. This is the first film, I think, where none of us have actually seen... Well, no. Okay, one of us hasn't seen it. So.
And it's a bit different from the usual ones we have. We've gone through a lot of sort of sci-fi action movies, so it'll be nice to shake it up a bit this
week.
Yeah,
definitely. This is going to be a good one, and that review will be up on Thursday.
Yep, our Galaxy Quest review. But yeah, you can follow us on the interwebs. You can find us at facebook.com/cinemasavvy. You can find us on Twitter at cinema_savvy. Or if you just prefer to listen to our audio review only, you can find us on iTunes. If you just search up Cinema Savvy Movie Podcast. Or you can find us on Podomatic at cinemasavvy.podomatic.com. So, we'll have more top 10 lists coming in the next few weeks. We'll have our Galaxy Quest review up on Thursday. Until then, thanks for listening.